So the floor is yours, guys.
Thanks for the introduction, Juliet. Really appreciate the words there. Hope everybody's having a great day. It's a good day for a good day. And today we're going to be talking about, as Julia said, the impact of COVID-19 on the future of healthcare. So let's go ahead and go to the first slide, Juliet. Disruptions due to COVID-19 has provided an opportunity to rethink many aspects of healthcare. And what we're finding out as we go forward is normal is going to be different. Normal is not going to be going back to what happened in 2019 or before. Things have changed, and those changes in many aspects are going to be permanent in healthcare. Can I have the next slide, please? So one of the things we want to look at is how Americans' concept of medicine and providers has changed. And as we go through these slides, wherever there is specific references cited from a journal, an article, or an authority, that is going to appear on the bottom of the slide. So let's start with this. Millions of Americans, newly out of work and newly unemployed, have accelerated changes in many things, including healthcare. And as you know, as you're aware from being in the healthcare industry, that has driven policy changes. Those policies continue to change, and further policy changes as we go forward are expected. There's been a shift towards consumers making their own healthcare decisions. This is really accelerated over the past 16 months or so. They want to change how they access and how they pay for care. Insurance has been unhinged in many respects from employment status. Many people were out of work, they lost their benefits. And so in order to have coverage, they needed to seek alternatives outside of their source of employment. Nursing homes, the standard of care in my entire career, may be on their way out. And there's been an increased focus on mental health. It's now more important than ever. And lastly, there has been a reckoning, as there is in a lot of areas in society, over the disparity of care among races. And that is on the forefront of the changes that are coming. Can I have the next slide, please? So we've made a number of predictions. And our first prediction is telehealth is here to stay. Next slide. So the vast majority of patients had never used telehealth prior to COVID-19. 78% had never used telehealth before. Today, 63% say they are comfortable participating in telehealth. Telehealth was originally viewed as a way to reach patients in need of healthcare in rural areas. That is happening. But it is also being utilized to a large degree by people in metropolitan and city areas as well. We have the next slide. The telehealth genie is out of the bottle. Everybody remembers I Dream of Genie and how that all works. So not quite that exciting, but telehealth is out and it's going to stay out. So telehealth is being seen by many as being quicker, safer, and easier way to access healthcare. As I said, it's no longer just for remote areas or underserved areas. Telehealth decentralizes the delivery of care so care can go directly to patients. And it's estimated that the COVID pandemic pushed the telehealth transition ahead by 10 years. 60% of the patients said they will continue to use some telehealth, even when in-office visits are safe. In our particular case in physical therapy, we have essentially been opened in our clinics since the end of May of 2020, but we are still doing a percentage of telehealth. People just find it an easier way, a safer way to get care. We're projecting that 25% of visits in the future will use telehealth. And that is going to span the spectrum from primary care to specialists. And interestingly, orthopedic surgeons have rated telehealth as being highly satisfactory, and that percentage is 80%. Next slide, please. Our second prediction is that telehealth is overcoming three big objections to care. And to a large extent, this exists in every healthcare practice, especially in physical therapy. And those objections are time, money, and distance. Next slide. The time objection really centers around, do I have enough time? Can I take time off work? Do I have the sick leave available to be able to spend 2 hours, 3 hours, whatever it takes to commute to, consume, and get back to work after my visit? The nice thing about telehealth is you can receive telehealth at any time. The money constraints, that has always been an issue in physical therapy, and I think most practices see this. How am I going to pay for my care? The nice thing about telehealth, at least recently, is co-pays and largely co-insurance has been subsidized by the insurance payer. So more people were able to access care at a lower cost. And of course, distance, how long is it going to take me to get there? Do I live in New York City? Do I live in Los Angeles or Chicago, where a short drive is going to take me an hour? I was coming back from Los Angeles yesterday, and we had an unfortunate circumstance with a truck that had caught on fire on the interstate. And what normally would have taken us 3 hours took us almost 6 hours. So distance can be an issue. You never know what's going to happen between your place and the place you're going to receive your care. But these three things together have changed how and where healthcare is provided. And it's really resulted in a seismic shift. And one of the main reasons that telehealth is going to continue is because these three big objections have been solved for the most part by telehealth. Next slide, please. So I want to look at patients, our consumers, and look at a case study in physical therapy because it surrounds our prediction number three. Next slide. So from patients to consumers, patients' choice in providers, plans, and service offerings are growing as private health plans offload financial risk from the government. And what I mean by that is that you're no longer limited to seeing a provider in your geographic area. You may want to see a provider several miles away who's a provider in your plan. Local access to care, sometimes limited. You can get greater access by accessing a provider in a different area. I live in Central California. Jessica and I live in Central California. We receive our medical care mostly outside of the community, not because there's anything wrong with the community, but the level of healthcare we can get at a university medical center is much more vast, much more complete, and actually much quicker than local care. Physical therapists, chiropractors, physicians, MIPS is a perfect example of this. If you're familiar with what MIPS is a reporting system used by the government to determine how you will be paid going forward with Medicare. We need to compete on cost, on quality, and on patient experience. And that need to compete on those three parameters is going to increase and continue to increase for providers across the spectrum. In physical therapy, we face a lack of compliance with patients completing their healthcare plans. Many patients do not come back for follow-up care. Only 35% of patients nationwide adhere to their plan of care for physical therapy. And that's important in a couple of reasons. Physical therapy has great benefit for patients. And as insurance companies have changed in how they manage their care for their consumers, physical therapy has been placed as a gatekeeper in a lot of respects in order to get a more intensive type of care. For example, if you hurt your back mowing your lawn on Saturday and you're having back pain, you used to probably, it was very common where we live, get an MRI almost immediately because they considered that the gold standard of care. Today in our area, you need to complete a plan of physical therapy in order to get an MRI. What we see happening is patients will come in and they'll say, oh, I'm here because I need to get an MRI, but my doctor says I need to have physical therapy first. And they'll come for two or three visits and stop. And pretty soon they show back up and they're there because they haven't got their MRI. They need to get their physical therapy. So completing plans of care is critical in physical therapy in the overall picture of healthcare, in that we're serving as gatekeepers and actually helping decrease the amount of waste in healthcare. Patients receiving physical therapy only attend 30% of their authorized visits. And the impact of poor follow-through on patient health and small healthcare businesses and physical therapy in particular costs an average physical therapy practice about $250,000 a year due to non-compliance with their care plan. And you see, if you're on Facebook at all, you'll see many companies, they are selling a package to get you more patients. And that's really interesting because most providers don't need more patients. They just need more patients to complete their plan of care. And a lot of money is spent in that industry. There's a lot of people who have popped up wanting to drive new patients to see you. So in physical therapy, it's a problem. I'm not sure how it is in your specific office, but we happened to be at UCLA yesterday seeing medical specialists. And one of the things that happened yesterday that we really enjoyed was we have never missed an appointment. We have never been late. We arrived early. The doctor was more than happy to see us because she doesn't always have patients follow up with their plans there either. Can I have the next slide, please? What we are seeing across the board in healthcare is that patient satisfaction is slipping. And it's slipping because patients' expectations of what they need and what they're getting has changed. Can you go to the next slide? So an SR survey of 1,488 patients pre and during COVID-19 found this. Pre-COVID, 10% of the population surveyed felt that messages were received in a timely manner. During COVID, that had dropped to 2%. With respect to questions being answered by the provider, it was also 10% pre-COVID and dropped to 3% during COVID. And in the area of the patient feeling that they are being heard, it went from 10% to 0%. And a lot of that was due to disruption of the healthcare system, changing rules and regulations. It seemed to change almost daily. But obviously, the satisfaction has decreased during COVID, and it's going to take some work to improve that satisfaction going forward. Can I have the next slide? Preference for live phone calls pre-COVID was 45%. Preference for live phone calls during COVID, which is really interesting because more people than ever were home and stationary, actually decreased to 31%. And what we found out was patients want their communication automated, and it actually increased during COVID-19. Now, as Juliet said in the beginning of the presentation, we are Weave users. We have been Weave users for going on 4 years, and it is an integral part of how we communicate with our patients.
Yeah, during COVID, we've been able to keep in touch with our patient load much more easily because we had the Weave phone system. We just didn't have the capabilities that it had prior with our old phone system. We had a number of our staff out with COVID or under quarantine because of an exposure. And because of the system that we had, we were able to have them work from home and it still had communication with our patients, and they didn't know the difference until they walked into the building. So we were able to still maintain that relationship and make sure our patients felt heard and answer their questions in a timely manner because we had Weave. But not everyone that we have talked with over this last year and a half had that. It's a really damaging thing to try and overcome once you break that trust with your patients. So I've been really thankful for having that. And Bob and I work from home, so we still have communication with our staff and our patients without giving out our personal cell phone numbers, which we used to do. So everything is centered through our office, which keeps that central focus on where they need to go for care. It's been really nice.
As we've talked to physical therapists and other healthcare providers across the country over the last couple of months, we've been trying to gauge where are they today compared to where they were in the first quarter of 2020. And in our case, we're actually at a higher level. We're at 105% of our patient capacity today as compared to pre-COVID. But as we talk to physical therapists around the country, some are really struggling to get back. And it ranges everywhere from therapists who have closed their doors altogether to 30, 40, 50, 60, 70%. And they just are struggling to get back to where they were. And in physical therapy, there's a pent up demand because people were not getting service. There's a pent up demand for elective surgery. And physical therapy is a big part of orthopedic and elective surgery. So what we've found out is people who were better at communicating with their patients, who had systems in place during COVID to maintain contact, to just do a check-in, hey, how you doing? Even if that was by text, those companies, those providers have seen a rapid return to their pre-COVID patient levels. And so that is very telling, I believe, in the value of communication. Mm-hmm. Could we go to the next slide? So what we're seeing and what we're predicting is that solopreneurs, small businesses, small practices are getting elbowed out. And this started many, many, many years ago. It is continuing to this day. Smaller providers are getting consolidated. The primary driver of this was hospitals acquiring small physician practices and creating a closed system, which allowed the hospitals, by the way, to significantly increase price and increase the cost to consumers and the cost of insurance. And I know a lot of the people we talk to believe that the problem with healthcare is the insurance industry, but it appears in some recent articles that the problem with health insurance cost is actually related to the mergers between hospitals, small physicians, and ancillary services. That consolidation, which was ongoing, started in the 90s, is continuing post-pandemic. The upcoming financial stress that causes on small providers is going to make it tougher on those least equipped to handle revenue decline. Now, payroll protection loans and other attempts to make up for lost revenues reached a lot of consumers, a lot of business owners in many, many different industries. But in healthcare, like every other business, some people deserving of PPP loans did not get them. And some people who didn't deserve them got them and did various things like buy condos, buy cars, you name it. So there's some problem with that, but a lot of people who really needed the money in healthcare to stay in business, to keep their staff employed. And we were really lucky in that respect. We were able to keep everybody employed full-time between doing telehealth and PPP and some other things that we did. As it's been demonstrated in the recent literature, mergers can lead to higher prices and lower quality of care. Big providers have more power to raise prices when negotiating reimbursement from insurance. Across the street from our office, our main office, there is a building with 80 physicians. None of those physicians refer to us because they're part of a hospital system today. But in the past, before they became part of the hospital system, if they didn't like what an insurance company was doing, they would just say, hey, we're not gonna see your patients unless you raise our price. They were always able to prevail because 80 physicians had a lot of patients on a given insurance. We tried that one single little office. We have a lot of patients with some insurance, but the numbers are so different that they don't pay any attention to a small provider. So it's a huge problem, something that everybody needs to be aware of. Next slide, please, Julian. So we just mentioned this, hospital mergers responsible for increasing healthcare costs. There is going to have to be a reckoning and a rethinking of competition rules surrounding hospitals. Mega providers do not deliver better quality care than smaller systems and independent providers. The literature is clear. Paying more, being consolidated, having a big campus doesn't necessarily equate to better care. And this reference is not here, but if you want to take a look at exactly what that looks like, you can go to US News and World Report, and you can look up the 100 best hospitals in the United States. And you can look up the best providers, and you can see what their revenues are. And just because you're a big hospital system doesn't mean you're a good provider. Mega providers have more leverage, as I mentioned, to get paid more, sometimes twice as much for the same procedure. Mega providers make decisions that account for 85% of all health spending. And that was in the Market Watch article that's referenced at the bottom of the slide. It was published last week. Their decisions are in their best interest, not in the public's interest. And I'm a Medicare provider. I'm on Medicare. And Medicare cuts can put independent providers out of business. That is why quality matters. That is why cost matters. That is why reporting what you're doing using the MIPS system matters. Having outcomes matters. So you have hard data that you can use when the time has come with your professional organization to advocate for your profession to stop Medicare cuts. And in the case of physical therapy, the American Physical Therapy Association, we have our own lobbyists, but we frequently will join forces with other professions whose interests are aligned in trying to stop Medicare cuts. And while we have been successful doing that over the years, it hasn't ever given us an increase. It has minimized the decrease. And overall, we're still probably worse off than we would have been. But if you are not, and I'm a firm believer of this, if you are not a member of your professional association for no other reason than they advocate for your profession, you should consider being a member. I believe that membership in professional organizations is very low. I'm on the nice end of the scale. I'm a life member of the Physical Therapy Association, so it doesn't cost me very much. But a lot of people do not see the value in being a member of the professional organization. You should look at that. Can I have the next slide? So as I said earlier, the pandemic has caused policy changes to be made. Lasting policy changes are coming. They're We have a saying in our office, if we improve something and it doesn't work, we reserve the right to improve it again. Policy is like that. There is going to be policy made. It will not work. It will be changed, but changes are coming. You need to be prepared for that. Can we go to the next slide? So what we've learned out of necessity in large part is, and what we're predicting is, policy changes to allow clinicians to practice virtually across state lines is coming. In physical therapy, there's a physical therapy compact. If you're a licensee of certain states, you can very easily practice in other states if you're a member of that compact. Nurse practitioners and physician assistants increasingly are going to be practicing without direct supervision, direct physician supervision. That occurs in California today. It has not damaged the healthcare system whatsoever. It's quite common to see a nurse practitioner or a physician assistant. Medicare needs to change its laws so that the telemedicine that was put in place for the benefit of Medicare beneficiaries or federal beneficiaries stays. There's going to be a further growth of healthcare retirement accounts or universal health coverage. Care is going to be moving from hospitals into the home. Maybe you've heard of hospitals without walls. That's what that is all about, where services are increasingly uncoupled from the parent facility and delivered on a home basis. An increase in remote working. It's an equals healthcare offerings becoming increasingly virtual and home-centric. People who normally went to an office prior to COVID, some of them will return, but we're seeing more and more industries saying, hey, we actually found our people to be more productive. We don't need that big building or expensive real estate. So increase in remote working is going to drive more virtual and home-centric care. And there's going to be the emergence of health campuses. That's kind of what you see today at the university level, where you have a hospital system, you have a medical school, you have every specialty and every ancillary service localized. That has its value. That's different from a hospital consolidating and buying up the competition, however. Can we have another slide? We're seeing this in physical therapy. Non-essential elective procedures are booming. And we see it primarily in orthopedic surgery. So we need a strategy for getting those elective surgeries and procedures back on track. There are post-pandemic backlogs affecting the health of millions of people. There is a need to develop a non-biased guideline for prioritizing procedures. How are we going to decide who receives what procedure? And who is going to decide that? You know, unfortunately, the opposite of that is occurring right now in India. It occurred in Italy during the pandemic. There were not enough resources to give care to everyone. And so guidelines were given of who was going to live and who was going to die. That is especially an acute problem today in India. We're talking about the opposite of that, but kind of the same idea. Patients requiring high risk or complex care, such as those with cancer, many people put off their care because they were afraid. They were afraid to get COVID. They were afraid to be exposed, but those people may not be able to wait for treatment. There needs to be a strategy of dedicating specific areas, either within a hospital or a dedicated facility, where elective care may be delivered. This is not a new idea. Hospitals have had this. They've had maternity wards. They've had the pediatric ward. They had the ICU. They had the COVID care. This can be done. Telehealth can be particularly effective for pre-op counseling. We need to develop algorithms to auto-prioritize patients in real time. Think about someone on a transplant list, and there is a mechanism to decide who gets an organ and when. But that kind of concept needs to be expanded across healthcare. And so more people can get, it's almost like a manufacturing just-in-time scenario where the supplies you need to build something arrive right at the right time so it can be built. That kind of thought process needs to be put into healthcare. There needs to be a transition of historically inpatient procedures to more outpatient care. And in order to get the backed up elective surgery done, there needs to be some thought to expanding beyond a 5-day work week for surgery operating rooms. Can we have the next slide? Our eighth prediction is nursing homes are going out of style, not assisted living facilities. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about strict nursing level care where people are housed because they do not have family relatives or another alternative to obtain care. And this is going to be replaced with in-home health aides. Next slide. So what happened during COVID-19 and why do we believe nursing homes are going to wane? Nursing homes and assisted living centers turned into jails during COVID. They locked the people down out of necessity. They kept family, friends, and relatives out and isolated the people in the facilities. And in some states, even placed COVID patients in long-term care and assisted living center situations. And because of that, over 1/3 of the COVID-19 fatalities happened in those settings. As I said, no visitors were allowed in or residents allowed out. Elderly Americans with needs. If you talk to a senior citizen who has needs, they really do not want to live in close proximity to hundreds of other people who also have needs. So there's a boom in in-home nursing care coming. Telehealth is going to help elderly citizens get a physician's care without leaving their homes. Artificial intelligence and wearable biometric devices will facilitate remote monitoring of medical status. That is an opportunity for certain healthcare professions to be on the forefront and be able to increase your patient population through artificial intelligence and monitoring of biometric devices. That is already happening, but it's going to be a growing industry. And then the situation with paramedics, which, you know, for the most part, they work for an ambulance company or a fire department. The next generation of paramedics are going to provide more on-site rapid care. They're going to be more of the physician extender than they are just the bridge to get a patient from a car injury or your house with a heart attack to a hospital. Next slide. Prediction number 9, the loss, isolation, and despair of COVID will have many people seeking mental health care. Next slide. So here's the problem. The pandemic plus recession plus social distancing has resulted in poor mental health. For any of those of you who watch TV occasionally you'll see Michael Phelps, now Demi Lovato, doing an ad for online mental health care. Talk therapy, I believe, is Michael Phelps's advertisement. But in January of 2021, 41% of all adults were reporting mental health care concerns. In the last 30 days, 1 in 10 have had suicidal ideation. In the 18 to 24 year old age group, 56% of those people became isolated when they lost access to universities and jobs. And in household with job loss, 53% were affected. from a mental health care status, and of people with no job loss just because of stress, 32% were affected. And if you think of people you've seen interviewed who are frontline essential workers in a hospital, I mean, people have a breaking point. And we've heard the reports and seen the firsthand reports of people who have reached that point. In essential workers under stress, increases in anxiety or depressive disorders was 42% versus 30% of those who were not essential workers. Starting or increasing substance abuse was 25% in essential workers versus 11% in non-essential, and suicidal thoughts in people in essential worker positions was 22% versus 8%. So this is a huge, huge issue. It's become such a huge issue that we specifically ask questions in physical therapy to identify if someone is having a mental health issue so we can attempt to get them to the right place. That is something that 2 years ago we never did. Today, it's with every new patient we see and every ongoing patient we see. Now, as you know, there's a lot of social unrest in the country. And there is also a long overdue reckoning of inequality in the healthcare system. And so things are changing in that respect. Can I have the next slide, Julia? We need to close racial and socioeconomic gaps and access to healthcare. So COVID brought to the forefront racial inequities in healthcare, and that was brought into full view. We need a plan to make sure the disparities are not made worse in the post-COVID era. Blacks and non-whites with higher mental health issues and lower access to care has become evident. The disconnecting of employment status to health insurance could help rebalance this. If there is, obviously, if you're not working, you have to go to somewhere to the marketplace to get your insurance. The options are limited, but you're also limited when you're connected to your employer's insurance because you're limited to that specific plan that that employer has. Decentralized healthcare delivery can democratize access to advanced experimental therapies and clinical trials. That is really an interesting area. There's a lot of ethical concerns with that. Let's go to the next slide. So improving flexibility and responsive capacity. We need to do that. That's our next prediction. So there needs to be an ability to scale up services. The federal government needs to develop a reserve corps ready to respond to emergencies. This is not FEMA that gets accessed when there's a natural disaster. It's not having to call the National Guard because you don't have enough healthcare workers in New York City or San Francisco, California. States need to set up their own reserve corps as well. Nurse practitioners and physicians assistants need to play a bigger role. We're going to see a shifting of primary care to non-doctors. It's estimated that's going to be in the range of 70%. And we need to decrease our reliance on China and India and move manufacturing plants back to the United States. Two points to that. One is medication. India actually produces the precursors, and China produces the precursors to a lot of medicines that we use. And those precursors became limited during the pandemic, and it's especially acute today in India. But it goes for everything. We had trouble getting masks for our company. We ordered directly from China and had trouble getting that. There were not enough ventilators. There's plenty of manufacturing capability in this country to get the job done. You can't rely on it being done overseas. We see in the last year, last 15 months, what happens with reliance on foreign countries. Next slide. want to talk about Weave for a second. Weave has been an absolute great addition to our office operations. As Jessica mentioned earlier, she's the Weave expert, I'm not. It allowed us to communicate with our patients much easier by text message, just reaching out and touching them during the pandemic. You want to talk about some of the other features, Jess, that Weave uses?
Well, going back to the poll questions, online reviews, telehealth, and then being able to text our patients. Previous slides, people don't want phone calls anymore. They just want to have a quick reminder. Most of them are sitting on Zoom all day, so they can't answer the phone, but they can answer a text. And that's been a really big game changer and helped us stay ahead of the curve, even pre-pandemic, but especially during the pandemic. Like Bob said, we were able to just reach out and send a message to patients just to check in on them and make sure they're doing well. And we were able to help them get access to other care beyond PT if they needed it. And then the online reviews, looking at the results, not too many have a great online presence, and that's become really important through the pandemic. Everything has shifted to an online platform. I never make it to the second page of Google. If you're not on the first page, you don't exist to me. So we've been able to bump up our online presence by asking our patients for reviews through the Weave phone system in a fairly easy manner that doesn't take up a lot of time from our staff. So those have, addressing the poll questions, those three points have been mitigated in the amount of work that it takes us in our office to retain patient relationships and build the relationships through having the Weave phone system. So it's been really great.
Talk about the fax that day. Fax issue for the fax ones. Yeah.
One of the things that's important to people understand is that, and everybody understands this, but I think we take it for granted, we carry around a pretty powerful computer in our pocket or in our purse every single day. Mm-hmm. And the nature of how consumers operate today is that they want to have a frame of reference before they decide on a provider, they decide on a restaurant or a purchase. And if you go back to 2010, people generally relied on 3 to 5 frames of reference. They would look online, they might read a review, they'd ask a friend, but after they had checked 3 to 5 sources, they usually would make their decision. That has been changing throughout the last 10 years, and it will continue to change. And today it is estimated that before a consumer makes a choice, makes a decision to use a product, purchase a service, go to a restaurant, they are now accessing 25 frames of reference. And most of those frames of reference that they reference are online. So reviews, as Jessica mentioned, are incredibly important. If they see somebody with 5 reviews versus 25, they're probably going to go to 25. If they see 100, they'll probably lean towards the side of 100. So that is really, really an important factor. Any other questions specifically? Let's look in the chat.
Yes. Does anybody have any questions for our speakers today? Thank you guys. That was a great presentation. Does anybody have any questions for our speakers today? Well, I did get some questions here, so I will go ahead and read them off. So a question that came in was, what methods have you used to try and attract new patients during this last year?
It's a great question. So I don't want to plug Business Made Simple, but one of the reasons we chose that framework is because it takes a simple look at a lot of business processes. And what we found out was customers don't necessarily buy the best product. They buy the product they understand the easiest and the quickest. And so messaging is incredibly important. We do a lot of Facebook advertising, and the Facebook advertising is focused on what problem we're trying to address, and the internal or the internal and external emotions that that problem causes. For example, low back pain, we would say it's not fair that, you know, you should have low back pain. You should be able to go out and play with your children. And we then tell patients or potential patients exactly what they're going to get in three short bullet points when they come to see us. And we tell them how to get it. You know, click here, call us now, text us here, use this chat bot. We get an awful lot of communication that comes through email, but more and more is coming through text. Mm-hmm. And so I think people overcomplicate how they deliver their messages. It's not about what I do. It's not about how, it is about what I do, but that's not the focus. It's not where I went to school, how many degrees I have. It's, I can solve this problem that you have, and this is how we're going to do it.
Perfect. Awesome. And I do have one more question here that I wanted to read off before we hopped off here. So what advice do you give to smaller practices with less resources to grow?
You gotta be able to leverage technology. And interestingly enough, I've been out of the office for about a year and a half. And one of the things that happened during that year and a half is Jessica and I sat down and we looked at all of the functions of our practice. How do we order? Where do we order? How do we pay for things? How can we solidify, simplify? One thing with Weave is it has electronic fax capability. Mm-hmm. So we can get a fax come right to our computer and we can just download it into our EMRs. Opposed to what we used to do, it would go to the copy machine. We would print it out. We would enter that into our EMR, and then we'd set it aside so we could call the patient. So we've streamlined a lot of things just through technology. And I think you need to do that as a small practice. And I think the other thing is hiring. We have gone away from hiring based on skills. We hire based on potential employees' attitudes. Because we can always teach skills. It's really hard to teach attitude. So if we hire the right person with the right attitude, we are way more successful than if we've hired someone because they could do X, Y, and Z. So I think those two things. And you know, if anybody would like to chat about that, our phone number is, or email is on the screen. Happy to sit down and talk to anybody about that.
Right.
But I think those two things primarily.
Perfect. And let's see, does anybody who's on the webinar today have any questions for our speakers today? Any questions about Weave at all? Please let me know. I don't want to miss anyone's questions. If not, then we will close the webinar for today. Just want to give you guys a couple of seconds here for any final questions. Going once, going twice, just want to be sure. Okay. All right. Well, thank you, Dr. Bob and Jessica, so much for your time today. That was a great, great webinar. A lot of useful information, and I hope that it was useful to everyone here. Just so you do know, this is recorded and we will email this information over to you. So you'll be able to listen to this great information again. So be on the lookout for that email, and I wish everyone here a wonderful day. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye, everyone.